Okay, good morning everyone. My name's Allan Fenwick. I work for Violin Memory. I've been in, a bit background about myself, I've been in the industry about 20 years, in and out of storage, some as an architect, some as an end user, consuming storage, managing storage. For the last 5 years, I've been with Violin. And a bit like Chris, I feel very privileged to have been involved with since the inception of Flash being adopted into the enterprise. The last 5 years has been very, very interesting. And I want to take you through some of the sort of experience I've had, some of my thoughts, some of my vision, plus a little bit around Violin and what the product does, where we fit in the market, and so on. So we often talk about the business value of moving to Flash. Why would you want to use Flash over traditional hard drive systems or hybrid systems potentially? Well, really we want to look at the benefits of it, because if hard disk drives were good enough for all of your workloads, Flash really wouldn't have much of a place in the data center. So some of the things that we do and the advantage of using Flash sometimes aren't immediately obvious. So that could be to do with reducing your time to market for new products as they come out. And this is around, you know, build times, DevOps, things that traditionally would have taken an awful long time to produce. If you move over to a faster storage medium, sometimes you can increase your productivity tenfold. And we've seen this happen in many, many different use cases. Also for what I would call high volume transactions. People have mentioned today about the amount of data the internet is consuming, is providing, the amount of data points that we have to process potentially in very, very short windows of time. Disk drives simply don't cut it in their traditional architecture. The latencies are too high. They can't cope with that volume of transactions. Also, you know, effectively managing most of those applications in a consolidated environment. Disk drives, you used to have to really over-provision a lot of the time, waste a lot of that capacity just to get the performance. With Flash, those metrics kind of go out the window. So really, it's a balance between, you know, the disk storage performance that you get, the Flash performance, and the compute performance. So when you use Flash, you'll often find that where you were wasting cycles with disk drive-based systems because the I/O latency was too high, you can consolidate an awful lot more workload onto a set of processor cores. So some of the benefits aren't immediately obvious other than just speed. Now this is quite a controversial slide in terms of some of these data points. People are talking about 2016 being the year of Flash. Now what I see predominantly is that if we talk about the traditional 15K disk drive architectures, they're now dying out. They don't have much of a place when you compare that to Flash. Reason is you want to over-provision those hard drives to get the performance. Again, with Flash, you don't actually have to do that. Now, some of the interesting things that I see are really around, if we look at some of the things Chris was talking about earlier, TLC, we look at 3D NAND, we start to look at more dense, more populated NAND technology. I'll come on to cross-point a bit later, but effectively, this point here, most vendors are around about $1.50 a gig for Flash. Now that typically involves some form of data reduction in that equation. So you'd be looking at dedupe and compression ratios of around 5 to 1 to get near that price point. Now that's okay, but really what we want to do with Flash is start to move it down at a raw cost, really to the sort of 30, 40 cents level, or at least lower than $1 for most people to adopt it wholesale. And that opens up a whole bunch of new use cases. Typically, over the last sort of 5 years ago when I started selling with Violin, we were looking at pain pills. So we'd walk in and we'd use a specific use case where there was a nasty Oracle application that was taking up all of the resources in a particular monolithic array and replace it with a standpoint, you know, on its own solution from Violin. What we're seeing now, as the cost comes down, we can start to look at more multi-platform use cases rather than just pain pills. Because traditionally, it was very expensive. We were talking about Flash would be upwards of $25 a gig 5 years ago. So things are really accelerating fast in terms of price. So a bit more about Violin. We've been in the industry for about 10 years now. We're a public-facing company. We've always been kind of on the bleeding edge of Flash technology, whereby we don't actually use SSDs, which we'll come into a bit later, but we're one of the original kind of pioneers that really did push the shared array value into the market. Prior to us, there were players like Fusion.io, who were all about PCI cards in servers. Now, that was okay for certain use cases, but actually what we tried to do was push out more shareable models over Fibre Channel, over iSCSI, where it acts and looks and smells like a traditional storage array. So we started out in 2005. We actually came out with a DRAM-based array originally. the 1000 series. And then we evolved that into using flash memory. Now, I'll come in a little bit more into why we transitioned from DRAM to flash, but flash at that point in time was still relatively new in the marketplace from an enterprise standpoint. Flash became really popular, and the manufacturing amount went up really because of consumer devices. So things like smartphones, tablets, all of those things drove the amount of capacity that the fabrication plants were driving to mass. And once that starts to happen, the cost starts to come down. So when you look at emerging memory technologies, their price is likely to be quite high to begin with until it starts to get adopted in the consumer market. Okay. As we evolved, we went through basically four generations of products right up to where we are now on the 7000 series system. In terms of the patents that we hold, we've got around about 200 of them, and they're all about managing flash from a low level. So the controller architectures, the way that we deal with dealing with flash, is all protected within our portfolio. And I want to talk a little bit more about what I mean by not all flash is created equal. So we don't use SSDs, which is quite a controversial point in many cases. A lot of vendors have gone down the path of using off-the-shelf commodity components to build an array, which is fine. That's one approach. It does have some drawbacks in terms of each SSD you buy from a different manufacturer, you place it in some form of chassis. They don't actually communicate with each other as a global entity. They're all separate drives that are controlled by the firmware or modified firmware from that manufacturer. We actually went a different approach, which we take the chips, the raw NAND chips, whether it comes from Toshiba or Samsung, and we put them on our own line cards. This was quite a controversial thing because most people were saying, well, why don't you just use SSDs? Why are you building it yourself? And a lot of people thought we were pretty crazy for doing this. But actually, if you look now at some of the more emerging technologies that are out there, you've got guys like DSSD that are manufacturing their own line cards inside the systems, custom flash modules. You've also got IBM. You've also got Pure Storage now that are kind of validating this approach because they want to be able to control the system as a whole, and they want to be able to control the amount of density that they can place inside the product. If you use someone else's form factor, it's not that easy. Okay, so what's important in flash is consistent low latency and performance as well. So there's no point in putting a whole bunch of flash into a system if you haven't got that predictable performance characteristic. Part of the algorithms that we've produced control how you can read and write data to flash. Reading data from flash is actually completely non-expensive and very easy to do. Anyone can produce a flash system that will produce very, very high IOP and low latency figures if you're just reading data. Where it becomes slightly more complicated is if you're doing mixed workloads or you're doing a heavy write-based workload. And obviously in the data center today, you'll have an awful lot of those characteristics going on. It's very difficult for you to predict exactly what workloads are doing what before it's on your system. So our IP basically allows us to read and write data to our devices without really any impact on latency or performance. So all of that is covered off. You'll always see very predictable performance regardless of what you put on the box or boxes. Management, obviously, you want some form of integrated management. You don't want to be having separate user interfaces for different components of your storage architectures. It makes much more sense if you can have a more unified single view, which is API capable. So if you have other applications you want to use for orchestration and so on and so forth, we've built a platform called Symfony, which allows you to do all of those functions. Data protection. Now, this was a reasonably interesting point that originally when these units were being sold out to market, the first flash arrays on the market from whoever, they didn't really have much software built into them. So they were literally just what we call a JBOF, like just a bunch of flash. And you had to have some other software to give you your data management functionality. So that was a bit of a barrier for people to adopt it. Most users were very much used to having a VMAX, which has got all of the features you can possibly imagine, or any alternative to that on a monolithic array. So what we had to do was basically go away and build all of those levels of functionality into the system. And I'll come on and show you what they are in a bit. Inline dedupe and compression. Now, this got extremely popular about 2 or 3 years ago. And it does have, obviously, some trade-offs that most people are aware of. If you put this in front of something very, very fast, you're likely to reduce the speed of it because there's an awful lot of processor and memory overhead that you need to do or need to take account for when you introduce those kind of data reduction technologies. is not free. And you will add latency to your stack if you introduce that. And also, not every single workload that you're going to run is going to work very well necessarily with dedupe. If I take a look at a database, a traditional Oracle database, probably won't deduplicate that much depending on how it's structured and how it's laid out. Compression, however, you will probably see a reasonable amount of reduction depending on what you're talking about. So it could be around 3-to-1 for compression. Where dedupe comes in really is around virtualization. So if you've got multiple copies of machines where you've got a web farm, you've got the same machine 200 times practically, 90% of that data is going to be the same, and you've deployed that virtually, dedupe's excellent for that. So you have to understand your data sets really to take advantage of data reduction. And endurance as well. I remember 5-6 years ago, the first sort of SSDs that people were deploying, they were burning out within sort of 3-to-6 months. It was very, very immature at that point in time. The endurance factors are getting better and better and better. And part of what you have to do as a vendor that effectively makes systems is control that wear ratio. And that's not a very easy thing to do. The majority of the systems out there now should last 5 years plus if they're using MLC-based technology. TLC, it's still not proven in the enterprise yet in terms of how long that will last. Just want to talk briefly through the flow of how the system is architected together. So we start out with NAND flash, raw dies. At the moment, we have a partnership with Toshiba. So we use their R&D and their roadmap effectively to get advantage of what the next generation of flash is. At the moment, we're using advanced 19 nanometer flash. So it's 2D. The next lithography down is 15 nanometer. And that will probably be the last litho that you'll see on traditional planar NAND. The next phase after that, you'll be looking at 3D NAND. 3D NAND effectively allows you to open up three bits per cell. And in essence, that means that you can start to drive a lot more capacity into a smaller footprint. The difficulty with that is that it does wear out faster and it's more error prone. So each litho that shrinks, each lithography that goes down and gets smaller and smaller and smaller, the more complex it is to actually signal process and understand whether you have leakage or whether you've got some form of CRC or error check that you need to take control of as a whole system. At the moment, each VIM, which is a very small footprint in size, so the VIM is our memory module component, our custom flash module, is 2.2 terabytes in size, and we have 64 of those in each system, or up to 64. We then have what we call V-RAID. Now, if we look at traditional RAID algorithms that are out there, they used to be most popular, RAID 1, RAID 5, and RAID 6. If you look at the penalty for things like RAID 5, you've probably got like 4 write operations for every operation that you go in and write data. Now, you imagine with flash, if you start to write 4 times more down to the flash memory, it's not the most ideal algorithm that you want to use because you will wear out the flash more quickly. RAID 6 is even more it will add about 6 times the amplification to that write-down activity because you have the double parity as well. We designed something called V-RAID, which is loosely based around RAID 3. And we take advantage of not really amplifying any of the writes down to the flash. So the wear ratios that we achieve are probably 10 years plus on most arrays in most use cases. We have a number of models, basically. So the largest model we do in 3U at the moment is 140 terabytes. And we do have the option to go into a modular rack array, which I'll show you guys later on, that goes up to 1.4 petabytes raw in one namespace. Chris Miller talked a lot about the future-proofing with NVMe and tiering and so on. Now, we actually built these systems based on this raw flash for a reason, because we can actually take advantage now. It doesn't matter whether it's SCSI or whether it's fiber channel or any of those protocol mechanisms, we can equally transition to NVMe very, very quickly. The whole box is designed around PCI and always has been. I think the difficulty with some of the main barrier to this stuff getting faster is the SCSI protocol itself. That's very, very inefficient. Most of the time, if you look at what the guys are doing with their newer generation 10 million IOPS boxes and so on, is they're using some form of RDMA over NVMe, where you bypass that whole SCSI stack, and effectively the box or the device becomes like a memory extension. rather than it being a separate SCSI storage entity, the idea is that you'll be able to access, you know, persistent storage as if it were memory. And that's probably the future of where things are going to go. I think the difficulty is that most of the applications out there don't really have the opportunity to take advantage of it yet. They're all going to be pretty new applications that you're going to see that will be able to do that. So there's still a whole bunch of legacy architecture that you need to be able to cover that still is perfectly suitable for fiber channel, iSCSI, and typical block level deployments. Like I was saying before, a lot of the use cases that we saw before were just individual pain pills. So someone would put on a section of Oracle databases onto just one box, leave it in the corner, the rest of your estate would still run on disk. What we're seeing now is people are realizing that it makes much more sense to consolidate most of your applications onto a platform rather than necessarily a DAS unit or just a bunch of flash. So a little bit more about the software. We've got basically most of the data protection features that you would normally want in the data center. So this would be asynchronous replication, stretch clustering, synchronous replication, and also snapshotting. So recovering from snapshots, having application consistency as well across your applications, not just crash consistent snapshots. That's all built into the product. And we've also got an inline data reduction engine that at the moment is based on 4K. It roughly equates to around about a third of the performance of the whole box if you switch it on. But the key is that we actually have the ability to turn on or off per LUN the data reduction. So if you've got data that you do not want to dedupe and compress, you have the ability to do that. And that's quite important if you want ultra high performance for a certain database and you don't want to dedupe or compress the data. You want to be able to choose, and our system allows you to do that. Symfony is based on a REST API as well, so effectively if you want to plug into the data that we collect, performance information, if you want to orchestrate or create LUNs from another orchestration engine, you've got the ability to do that with Symfony. Okay, so Concerto OS is, in essence, the whole operating system. It covers all of the elements in the equation, so we have one single operating system. If we look at other products out there, if you want to achieve the same level of functionality, you have to have several different components and interfaces to do it, whether that be VPlex, it could be SVC, it could be some other sort of, you know, management level that you've got, or heterogeneous management. And this is all our intellectual property. So people out there have criticized in the past saying that we built it from other acquisitions that we've made, but it actually does all completely belong to Violin. That's quite an important point. This is a really busy slide. I won't go into it too much, but we've been working a lot with the OpenStack stuff that was mentioned earlier. So we've just released the Juno compatibility. So that's fully certified for OpenStack. We do offer, when we do replication, WAN optimization as well and encryption. So if you want to replicate data from site A to site B, you can take advantage of that built into the product as well. And we've also got VMware integration, so the full pretty much suite of SRA and so on and so forth. And we're still working on some of the later VASA providers, but it's a continual process of making sure that we integrate with VMware correctly. Okay. A little bit more about the platforms that we offer. So we offer individual arrays. The first is a small entry point. Basically, we start at 8 terabytes. As you go more into the higher density, higher workload, we have the FSP 7300, which offers you up to 1 million IOPS. And then if you want to go for full performance without dedupe and compress, you've got the FSP 7600, which is 1 million IOPS in a box and 140 terabytes in 3IU. Now, we will be releasing in the next forthcoming few months additional models to these that will double in performance. It will double also in other characteristics as well. I can't release too much at the moment, but we are roughly every 12 to 18 months able to double the amount of storage capacity in that footprint, broadly speaking. And also with that, you have to be able to then double the performance that you achieve within that footprint. So you'll see devices that are capable of 2 million IOPS in the shelf coming soon. The scale product, I'll just come onto this a little bit more, but We offer what we call Scale Smart. So Scale Smart is a pay-as-you-grow mechanism, effectively. When you look at buying storage these days, one of the perils of having a scale-out architecture is that each time you add an array or a shelf or a brick or whatever you want to call it, typically that has to be the same size as the first one that you bought. Can't be smaller, because you've then got to build it incrementally on that model. What we do at Violin is we actually allow on-site the box fully populated with a flash, but we only license you for what you paid for. So if you grow into it, we offer 8 terabyte increment licenses. And it basically allows you to kind of scale up and scale out. Now, you can mix and match any of those lines that we talked about earlier underneath a single pair of, a dual pair of controllers or 4 controllers at the top of the rack. That means we can get about 1.4 petabytes raw capacity in a rack. If you were then to take dedupe and compression into the equation, you could probably look at 3 to 4 times that in a single namespace in one rack. So it's a very, very dense solution compared to what you would have seen previously with disk, or certainly high performance, what we call, you know, primary workload disk. I just want to go through a couple of use cases that we've done recently. So Feral Gas is a company over in the States that we basically managed to collapse down all of their tiers of storage into one. They had the traditional setup where you might have high performance, general performance, and archive. It didn't make a hell of a lot of sense for the sort of applications they were dealing with, having that traditional setup. So they went down from basically about 4 times the performance previously, where it was hitting their business SLAs. Moving to flash dramatically changed things. They had a classic problem with tiering on their previous system, where if you can imagine, you've got cyclical workloads in your business that may only occur once a month. So if you do a billing run at the end of the month, and that data has been stale, hasn't really been accessed for a month, your tiering software may have actually put that into a archive tier. But then when you want to run that report, you've then got to suck it all back out of that archive tier again and put it into your fast tier. And that can take time, because you've got to read the data from where it was and put it into somewhere fast. So if you imagine with Flash now, we might be looking at a concept of saying, well, actually, everything's pretty fast. We can move it from MLC potentially to TLC or to wherever is necessary within that Flash ecosystem. And that's something that's quite interesting we're looking at the moment. I probably won't go into these in too much detail, but you can read for yourself. There's a few logos there. And we've also got quite a lot of the major corporations in the world at the moment running us predominantly for their primary workloads. So these are the mission critical applications that don't really lend themselves that well to be put, let's say, out in the cloud or somewhere off-prem. Most of those guys are using this kind of technology to make sure that it gives them that extra level of performance that lasts them for the next 5 years before they re-architect their applications to go and do something else or more modern. Because that cost of change of asking guys in development to re-dev those applications in many circumstances is a hell of a price. Thousands upon thousands and thousands of dollars and man hours to get them off that platform. So quite often Flash is an alternative to give them that leeway and make sure that it's more cost effective in terms of, yeah, you're putting a plaster over, but you're using infrastructure to solve those problems. And with that, I think I've run out of time, Nelly. So any questions, anyone?
What is it that you're going to have now that will differentiate you from all the other traditional vendors? Because, as you say, you had that advantage there before that you could come in and say, right, I'll take your biggest IOPS pain point and I'll cure that problem for you.
Yeah.
But now it's this more level playing field. So,
yeah.
What is it now that everybody else is starting to play catch up and getting to that flash point that still gives you the advantage?
That's interesting. So I think the main barrier that people have had has been cost, and also the software that's associated with it, the manageability of the whole lot. So if you want to go and take some SSDs, build your own, you've then got to buy some software to manage that as well. It might not be what you would call enterprise class. So with our technology, or our it's more enterprise focused, where you're not kind of rolling your own. And that also comes with all of the sort of 10 years worth of basic coding into the software, so it's all hardened. If you take your own approach, you might find that you'll end up in a situation where it's unreliable and it doesn't achieve the same level of SLA or performance that you thought it would. Does that make sense?